Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Haunting Midlife by Leah Davis and L.A. Boruff. Narrated by Coleen Marlo. Chapter 1. Done. Finally. After months of hard work, starting and stopping, a paragraph here and a chapter there. Now it was done. After struggling for the last several weeks with the ending of the novel, I typed the end with glee and a feeling of accomplishment. The next step was to let that book baby sit on my computer and marinate until I returned from Philly. A few weeks of perspective would help me see errors more easily before shipping it off to my editor. I leaned back in my comfy office chair and stretched. My muscles nearly creaked as they loosened. Ah, how I missed my younger days of writing for hours on end only to jump up and bounce from one activity to the next without a crick in my neck or stabbing pain in my back. Picking up my coffee cup, I frowned to find it empty. Again. Ugh. It seemed like I'd make a cup and it would set until it got cold, or I'd turn around and somehow it was empty. I set the mug back on my desk and ran my hand through my hair. It got stuck halfway down to my shoulder. What the hell did I have in my hair? Something sticky. Ew. Must have been that late night. Or was it an early morning snack? Leftover donuts from this morning? Or yesterday morning? Olivia had dropped them by at some point. Wait, what day was it? I'd been holed up in my office for too long. I needed sleep. But hey, it was all worth it. Another manuscript in the books. Pun intended. Standing, I picked up my cup and my trash can full of snack wrappers and takeout boxes. Damn, how long had I been in the office? AKA the writing cave. By the look of the overflowing trash can, I'd guessed a week. That couldn't have been right. Surely it wasn't that long. I tended to lose track of things when I got in the zone. Clay had always taken good care of me when this happened. Owen, Alfred, and Larry had been trying to keep my head above water, so to speak, but every time they tried, it made me think of Clay doing it, and then I'd get sad again, making it harder to focus on the words. I opened my office door and stepped out into the downstairs hallway. I had closed the door around midnight, I think, to keep Snooze and his new girlfriend out of the room so I could focus. Lucy, the pretty white cat I brought back to life over the weekend, could talk, like full sentences. And holy crow, that little kitty was chattier than a teenage boy. Well, boy of any age. Man, could they talk. Lucy would fit right in. Most people thought it was the girls that always had diarrhea of the mouth. I'd never raised a teenage girl, but I had raised a teenage boy, and Wally hadn't shut up for like 4 years. Emerging from the hallway, I caught the scent of bacon and coffee. I gravitated to the yummy scents like they were calling me. When I reached the dining room, just off the kitchen, though it was technically the same room because of the open space, I froze. Alfred, the house ghoul, stood near the stove, flipping bacon with his Kiss the Cook apron on. Sammy was a few feet behind him, holding out a plate. I soon realized why when Alfie reached over to another skillet and launched a pancake at him. With a surprising show of skill for a kid his age, Sammy caught the pancake with his plate. Hey, I cheered, go Sammy! 7 heads turned toward me, staring like I had grown an extra set of arms. Owen, my friend, roommate, and mentor, raised his black eyebrows and pushed his dark hair out of his face. Sam and Olivia, my childhood best friend and his wife, who was my current best friend and had taken the central role as my person with a capital P, grinned as Olivia eyed my hair. Just to be sure, I checked. Nope, no extra arms. But my hair was a mess, half up in a sloppy bun and half down around my face. The latter had the sticky donut yuck in it. Zoe, my sort of adopted daughter, snorted and turned back to her pancakes, while Wally, my biological son, barely spared me a glance as he ate. He was long used to my crazy appearance after emerging from my cave. Is Sammy out of school? I asked as I tugged down my oversized tee and pulled up my leggings. Comfy clothes were staples for a writing binge. Again, I wondered how long I'd been in the writing cave. Olivia burst out laughing while Sam asked, "Did you sleep last night?" "Last night? Oh, it's morning already?" "Yeah," Olivia said with a giggle, It's teacher's planning day. No school today. Oh, I had lost a few days. Alfred came over and took my cup and the trash can from me. He glared at me and grunted. Then he pointed to the stairs. I didn't need a translator to know what he meant. I needed a shower. Probably pretty badly. Owen frowned at me.
You need to hurry, or you'll be late for your flight.
What? What time is it? I glanced at the clock on the stove and cursed low enough I hoped little Sammy didn't hear me. That kid was like a parrot. He repeated everything he heard. 7 o'clock, Olivia said with a snicker. She loved being right, and I hated that she often was. I ignored her amusement. No doubt I'd hear about this moment later on. But reality was starting to come back to me. I had 2 hours to shower, dress, and pack. It was a good thing I'd created Zoe's fake ID the night before. Lucy, the devil, not the cat, helped me with a little magic that made her legit in the human databases. Zoe had been an orphan shifter who I'd taken in when my friends and I had saved her and a bunch of other kids from a shifter fighting ring, sort of like dog fighting, but with poor shifter kids. Many of them had been very, very young, and we'd found a lot of dead kids. Too many. Ava! Olivia exclaimed. Go! I jumped and hurried toward the stairs. Right, yes, go. Zoe, Wally, and I were flying to Philly. The plan was to rent a truck there after we packed up the house and drive it back to Shipton. It wasn't going to be an easy week, getting all of the stuff for my life with Clay packed up or donated. But it was time. It was past time. I had to move on. After I showered and dressed, I stared down at my half-packed suitcase and tried to remember that I had a house full of my own belongings. I had a bigger wardrobe there than here. I didn't need to take much. A knock sounded on my bedroom door. Come in. Owen opened the door but didn't enter. He was a little old-fashioned like that. Polite.
Are you taking Larry with you?
I asked and he said he wanted to stay here to help you. I placed my toiletries into the small carry-on. I wasn't checking any luggage, and I'd told the kids to do the same. Zoe would fit into some of my older skinny clothes I'd hung on to in the hopes of losing weight.
As if.
If she didn't like them, I'd donate them. Out with the old. It was time to move on from more than just grieving my Clay. I picked up the mini suitcase and turned toward Owen. Listen, if the house starts as crap, have Alfred grunt at him. I wasn't sure that would work, but it was worth a try. Winston usually listens to him. Since my old house had taken on a personality, we'd had to name him. Winston was as good a name as any. He seemed to like it anyway. Owen laughed.
Winston doesn't bother with me because I'm a necromancer. I think he gave Olivia crap because she's human. No magic.
I hadn't thought about that. Sam is human. Owen hummed.
True. But Sam also grew up with you and has spent a lot of time in this house.
That made sense. He'd been in and out so much, he'd learned long ago about my family and me being witches. Are you going to be okay here for a week? You'll have to go get groceries or at least be here for delivery. Alfred knows not to answer the door.
Ava, I've been a necromancer longer than you and know how to take care of a ghoul, a magical house, and an animated fleshed-out skeleton who has been dead for 30-some-odd years.
Larry had been a big surprise. When my fat, old, immortal Maine Coon cat, Mr. Snoozerton, led me to a little white dead kitty and asked me to animate her. I figured out I had the power to do more than animate. I could heal the dead. Something as yet unheard of, or only heard in rumor. I'd given it a shot on Larry, a skeleton I'd accidentally animated over the winter. And he'd grown his flesh back, all of it, to the point that now he looked perfectly human, alive, and according to Zoe, freaking hot. And don't forget two immortal cats, one of which can talk quite well. I frowned. Maybe I'll call Wade and just have him pack up the house. Leaving this chaotic menagerie to Owen suddenly seemed insane. Owen broke his unspoken rule of not entering my room and crossed over to me.
Ava, stop.
He took my hands, forcing me to look at him.
You are going. Everything here will be fine. Not to mention, Sam will be here if I need anything. And the coven said they'll help if anything weird happens.
I snorted. The coven, my coven, because I was the high witch in charge, loved all the weird stuff that happened in my life. They'd probably be all over it with glee. Not that I blamed them. The the insanity that was my life was most of the time pretty damn cool. Owen let go of my hands and moved to the door.
You put this off long enough. It's time to let go.
His words reflected my earlier thoughts almost exactly. That had to mean something, and he was right. I could do this, but boy did I need a nap, and I didn't think I'd be getting one anytime soon. After saying goodbye to everyone in my house, two humans, one small human, one ghoul, one animated dead person, who may or may not be a ghoul now, I wasn't sure, two immortal cats, one devil who had appeared, I wasn't sure when, but there he was, and one self-aware house, Owen drove Wally, Zoe, and me to the airport. When he pulled through the drop-off lanes, I spotted Drew and my heart did a little dance while my eyes drank in the sight of how sexy he was in his sheriff's uniform. I'd been planning on sending him a sweet text right before I put my phone on airplane mode, but this was so very much way better. Heart soaring, I got out of the car, and Drew quickly pulled me into his arms. His mouth claimed mine, and I melted into him like I was meant to be there, like I'd always been meant to be there. Pulling back, I smiled up at him. I thought you weren't able to come. He shook his head and traced my jaw with his fingertips.
I still can't. I've got to run, but I wanted to see you off.
Laughing, I tucked my arms around his waist and hugged him tightly, relishing how much taller Drew was, and bigger. I liked feeling small as I hugged him. Drew had been with me when I'd gotten the call from Clay's Uncle Wade that the house had sold. Drew had insisted that he would come with me and wouldn't hear any arguing from me. However, plans changed. He had to help out with a case in Acadia National Park and couldn't leave town. There'd been a murder, so he was assisting the Rangers. Pulling back, I smiled up at him. I'll only be gone a week. But that felt like forever, knowing Drew wouldn't be there. Or maybe I just dreaded the coming job. How strange to feel so lost without Drew. I hadn't felt that way in a long time. I'd learned to be pretty self-sufficient. He eyed me closely and frowned.
Have you been up all night?
I gasped dramatically. Who, me? I looked around at the people milling about the drop-off area. Surely not. A crooked grin formed on his handsome face.
You finished the book.
I flashed him a brilliant smile, beaming with excitement. I did, and I'll sleep on the flight, then again when I get to Philly. The flight would be way too short to sleep long. It wasn't even 2 hours. I wasn't meeting the new owner, Haley, for a couple of days, so I'd have time to nap, pack, and get my emotions in check before letting a stranger into the house, into her house now.
Make sure you get some sleep. After you've rested, call me.
He kissed my forehead. I wrapped my arms around him again and held him for a moment. I will, I promise. Wally stuck his head out of the automatic door.
Hey, Drew. He raised his eyebrows at me. There's not a big line of security. Let's go.
After waving him back inside, I popped one more kiss to Drew's lips, then grabbed my small suitcase. Bye, I called. I walked back through the double doors, not turning until I had to. Zoe grabbed my hand and tugged me toward the gate.
I read all about flying online. We check in, get our tickets, then go through security.
Zoe, I checked us in at home, Wally said. We all have our tickets. Straight to security.
She gulped audibly.
Oh, time for that?
Throwing my arm around the young girl, I turned her toward the small line in security.
Stop fidgeting, I said softly. I can't help it.
Her barely audible whisper was more of a squeak.
What if something goes wrong? I don't exist, at least not as far as the humans are concerned.
Stop talking about that now. We were too close to the front already.
And chill.
She'd put a ball cap on to hide her ears just in case they made an appearance. We had a glamour on her, but I didn't want to trust that it would definitely 100% work. Okay, take off your shoes and put them in these buckets. I set an off-white tray in front of her. And put your backpack in there, too. I'd already coached her not to wear jewelry or a belt, so once the shoes came off, we were good.
Miss,
a tired-looking woman leaned over. Hat off, please. Zoe smiled at her with wide, nervous eyes. We hadn't been able to do anything but glamour for her tiger eyes, which hadn't shifted back to human since I animated her. If that slipped, well, we were just screwed. I breathed a sigh of relief when the hat came off and there were no ears.
It's okay, I murmured,
step into that machine, and it just scans your body to make sure you don't have a weapon. This was the big test. Would the machine be fooled by a glamour? I had no idea. If her ears popped up or tail popped out, we were screwed with a capital F. But it seemed to go well. Then, as Zoe stepped through to the other side and I walked into the scanner for my turn, Wally hissed at me, "Mom, her tail!" Turning my head back to Zoe, I gulped when her tail appeared out of the bottom of her skirt. In her relief to get through the scanner, she let it slip, and the agent was turning towards Zoe. The whole thing happened in slow motion, like in a movie. "No!" I yelled and dropped to the floor, pulling all the attention on me. The agent, who had been about to look at Zoe, rushed to my side, as did Wally. All eyes swung around me, including Zoe, peering over the agent's shoulder. "Sorry," I said, getting to my feet and rubbing my butt. "I just tripped and fell on my tailbone." Zoe's eyes slammed shut and she disappeared from sight. I'd forgotten to glamour her tail. All I could do now was hope she either managed to tuck it up inside her clothes or made it disappear.
"Are you sure you're all right, Mom?"
Wally asked with his nostrils flared. "I'm fine. Stop fussing. You know I'm just clumsy." The security agent gave me a scathing look but backed away. We finished our scan without incident. We weren't even out of Maine yet. This was going to be a long trip. Chapter 2. When the cab dropped us off at the house in Chestnut Hill, a suburb of Philadelphia, my stomach churned, and dread froze me in place. The last time I was in this house, I was a depressed, grieving widow. Some things hadn't changed. I was still a grieving widow, just not as depressed. I was proud of how much moving back to Shipton had helped me. With a sigh, I stared up at the split foyer and tried to make myself walk forward.
"Come on, Mom." Wally put his hand on my shoulder. "We're ready for this. We've talked about it until we couldn't talk about it anymore. Just go in."
He was right. That didn't mean it would be easy, though. With an encouraging look from Wally, I unlocked the door and went inside. I didn't fall apart as soon as I set foot in the foyer, so that was a plus. Wade had turned on the AC so the house wouldn't smell closed up. I thought it felt amazing.
"Jeez, it's cold in here,"
Zoe muttered. I pointed at them, my voice full of threat and sweat on my brow.
"Don't touch the AC. There are blankets in the hall closet and a slew of warm clothes upstairs. Layers."
My emotions had triggered my hot flashes. Then again, at my age, simply waking up triggered my hot flashes. And sometimes I woke up in the throes of one without doing anything to cause it. As I moved deeper into the house, I got a strong sense of being watched. I climbed the stairs to the main floor while Wally took Zoe downstairs. He'd pretty much taken over the entire downstairs when he was in junior high. As I stood in the upstairs living room, I turned around, looking for the source of the odd vibe. Then a warm sensation flowed over me, and I swore I smelled Clay's cologne for just a moment. Okay, so that was just crazy. It was the grief that made me sense him. Being here for the first time in several months, all the memories of our life together. It had definitely been a good one. Yeah, it was the grief causing me to feel like Clay was about to walk through the door any second. I went to the kitchen, not thinking about how I'd seen my mother's ghost a few weeks ago. It isn't possible that Clay would be there. Not possible at all. If he was here, I would have sensed him years before. Opening the fridge, I nodded at nobody in particular. It was empty, just like I'd left it in October. "Pizza it is," I mumbled and shut the refrigerator door. I'd meant to send Uncle Wade some money to buy a few staples for the week, but had forgotten. I'd also gotten way too used to Alfred handling it all. He usually made a list and either put it in an order for delivery or sent Owen to the store. They were spoiling me. To be fair, I was providing them a place to live and food to eat. And for dead things, undead things, they sure did eat a lot. Not to mention the entertainment. They talked me into upgrading the internet service because Zoe had introduced Alfred and Larry to something called TikTok, and they wanted fast upload speeds. Apparently, they were trending. It was already late afternoon, and I'd skipped my lunch. Not to mention I never got my nap. At the moment, my stomach was letting me know all about that mistake.
The combo of sleepiness and hunger was threatening to make me grumpy, maybe even hangry.
I gave Zoe the tour, Wally called from the living room.
Great. I brought up the app for the local pizzeria and placed an order for 2 larges with the works. Then at the last second changed it to 3. Leftovers were always a good thing. I'd never taken the app off my phone. Once we were finished here, it would be time to delete all the local apps. I had no plans to return since I'd had Clay cremated. His urn waited still in the living room for me to figure out when and where I wanted to spread them. As a necromancer, even though at the time I hadn't been a practicing necromancer, I wouldn't ever bury a loved one. I'd proven even an old skeleton could be animated by someone powerful enough. But then, once I had Clay's ashes, I hadn't been able to bring myself to actually do anything with them. Instead, he'd gone over the fireplace to watch over Wally and me. I didn't bother with asking Zoe what she liked. The kid could eat all of us under the table and didn't seem picky about anything. The fact that Zoe, Snooze, his girlfriend Lucy, and now Larry could eat food mystified me. Technically, they were undead. I'd animated each of them at one point or another. Ghouls, kind of. If Alfred would let me cut his strings, no doubt he'd join in on the Nosh Fest as well. After I placed the pizza order, I stared into the kitchen and breathed out a long, drawn-out sigh. With the flick of my hand, I opened all the cabinets at once to inspect the contents. Not much. Long shelf-like type stuff, like soups. I didn't have the energy to start this. I flicked my wrist again and shut the doors. Wade had dropped off bubble wrap in boxes. They were piled in the laundry room off the kitchen. But I was too tired from the flight and being up all night to start packing. A knock pulled me from my haze. Before I got halfway to the door, Wally was already there. "It's too soon to be the pizza," I called. Wally ignored me and flung the door open. "Uncle Wade!" Wally hugged the older man and stepped back to let him in. Wade met my gaze and instantly crossed the room to me, pulling me into a tight hug. My emotions went haywire. Wade was Clay's uncle and had adopted me as his own early in the marriage. He was the only one to keep in touch and make sure I was surviving Clay's death. It had nearly taken me out as well. Clay's parents didn't care for me, so they'd barely been in touch. That didn't bother me. We told them early on that I was a witch, hoping for acceptance and tolerance. We'd gotten the opposite. What pissed me off was that they'd also written Wally off when it became clear he'd inherited my powers. I buried my face in Wade's chest. Hugging Wade had almost felt like what I imagined a hug from my father would feel like.
"It feels like a lifetime since I saw you last."
Wade stepped back and framed my face.
"How are you?"
He'd cut his salt and pepper black hair short, nearly a buzz, and made him look like a big, burly general. He'd always been a big man, but as he got older, he kept up his activity level, so he wasn't getting all saggy yet like so many of us did when we aged. Hell, I was already saggy. No plans to do anything about it either, except maybe just try not to gain any weight.
Squeezing his hands, I smiled and tried not to look overly tired.
"I'm good." I meant it too. In fact, I realized that I was better than good. "You need to stay for dinner. I ordered more than enough pizza." Wade yanked me into another quick hug.
"I think I will."
"Come sit." I looked around for Zoe, wondering where she'd snuck off to. Wally noticed my expression and said,
"Zoe's taking a shower. She actually beat me to it. She's fast."
The water heater in this house sorely needed replacing. While we had 2 bathrooms, if they both ran the shower at the same time, the water went cold.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.